Okay, so thank you very much. So first I want to thank the organizer for inviting me to this conference. It has been a pleasure to review this material, and in fact I think I have found some simplifications, so there will even be a new theorem at the end of my second talk. So that's interesting. So then the plan of the talks will be, so I plan to be as elementary as possible, so I hope I will bore all the experts and the students will get something. And then the plan today is just to talk about Hermitian symmetric spaces and Shimura varieties, to get an idea of what are the Shimura varieties, what will be the objects we are working with. Then the plan for tomorrow will be to explain about vector bundles on these Shimura varieties, so the interesting vector bundles that one can construct in these Hermitian symmetric spaces, and metrics on these spaces. We will see that they are singular, and then we will see how to extend the Arakelov theory that that Sule explained to us the first week, how to extend this theory to deal with these singular metrics. Then Jean Brunier will come to give the second part, he will give examples of how to compute the intersection numbers that appears in these kind of varieties. Okay, so let's start about Hermitian symmetric spaces. I hope now there are notes on the web side where you have more details about IYN to see, and there are also a list of exercises a little bit to follow the exposition. Now, to understand what are Hermitian symmetric spaces, let's start with an object that we have seen many times, the upper half plane. So this is the set of points x plus iy inside C, such that y is bigger than 0. And we know that the group SL to R acts on H by Möbius transforms. So the matrix A, B, C, D acting on a point tau is just A tau plus B divided by C tau plus D. And now we can look at the stabilizer at the point I. And if we look at what are the matrices A, B, C, D that fixes the point I under this Möbius transform, we will see that this is just the set of matrices of the form C, S, C minus S, S, C, where C squared plus S squared is equal to 1. And this is exactly the group SO2, which is isomorphic to U1, to the unit circle. Hence, we have an equality that tells us that the upper half plane is just equal to SL2R divided by SO2. Okay, so this is quite classical. But now if we look at this equality, there is something odd in this equality. Because this part, the part on the right, is just a real object. It's a real group divided by a real subgroup. So in particular, it should be a real manifold, while the left-hand side is a complex manifold. Where this complex structure comes from? And in particular, this is not general, because I can look now, for instance, at SL3R, and I try to divide SL3R by SO3. I mean, this is just the same group, or just one more dimension, and I take out, I divide by the maximal compact subgroup. I can look at the dimension over the real numbers of this quantity, and this is 5. So there is no way that this can have a complex structure. So the fact that this is a complex variety should come from somewhere. So it's not something that is general for any quotient of a Lie group by a compact subgroup. So the point is where the complex structure comes from. Now the point is that if I look at the stabilizer of A, this SO2, in general, the big group will be denoted by the letter G, and this subgroup will be denoted by the letter K, because this will be compact. In this case, K is abelian and is non-discrete. In particular, it's compact. So it's isomorphic to S is isomorphic to U1, as I said before. Hence, I can find an element, so K acts on the tangent space at the origin of this D. So we will write D, this quotient, G mod K, and 0 will be just the class of the unit element in G. Now the compact group K acts on the tangent space at 0 on D, and we can find an element. So there exists, since it is discrete and non-compact, I can find elements of any order. I can take any root of unity. In particular, I can find an element J inside K such that the action of J in T0 of K satisfies that J squared is minus the identity. So the fact that K is non-discrete and abelian, is a circle, means that I can find at least an element J that his action on the tangent space is 0 to the square is minus the identity. But this is an almost complex structure. So this is an almost complex structure. And now the fact that K is abelian, this means that J commutes with every element in K. And this implies that I can extend J to the whole D by conjugation. I can define J on the tangent point at G0 of D just by J, G minus 1 and J. So I can define G at the point P in this way. And it turns out that extending this almost complex structure on the whole variety, it automatically is integrable because it is invariant under G, and it gives me a complex structure on the manifold. So the fact that this H was this quotient, the complex structure on H comes in some sense by some group theoretical reason. So it comes because I can find this element in SO2 that gives me this complex structure. What fails here? So the point is that here I cannot find an element that commutes with all the elements in K and that has this property that the action on the tangent space satisfies that J squared equal to minus I. Just because the center of SO3 is trivial. So there is no element except the identity that commutes with all the elements on SO3. Okay. So now, if we want to generalize this idea, now we put a definition. The first part, so if I have a D, a complex manifold, and then G is a Riemann structure, we will say that D is Hermitian. If G of UB, so G is the Riemannian structure, this is a complex manifold, so it will have a complex structure J, which is multiplication by I, and then we'll say that it is Hermitian if these two structures are compatible. So it means that J of UB is equal to J of JU JB, and then the group of holomorphic, so then this Hermitian if satisfies this, and then the group of holomorphic isometries is denoted as is of D, and then the connected component of the identity will be denoted is D plus. So this is just the connected component of the identity. Now, the second part of the definition. Now assume that D is a connected Hermitian space, And then it is called symmetric. If for all points P inside D, there exists an SP inside these isometries of D plus, holomorphic isometry, such that SP is an isolated fixed point of SP, and SP to the square is equal to the identity. So it's an involution. So it will be symmetric if I have a lot of symmetries. So in particular, every point on D has some kind of inversion around P. So P has to be an isolated fixed point, and it has the square has to be the identity. Okay. For instance, the basic example, I can take D equal to Cn with the usual inversion on each point. Mm-hmm. But in some sense, this is the example, the trivial example, and this is the one I don't want to have.
Okay, how this works?
No? Oh, ah, no, this is not. Okay. Oh. Yep, this one. Good. Okay, and then I can leave it working. Okay, now we want to, so one can easily see that H is another example of a Hermitian symmetric space. And these are, in some sense, complex varieties that have a very rich collection of symmetries. So it will be candidates of being the quotient of a Lie group by a compact subgroup. And in fact, we can classify them. There is the first theorem is that if the D is a Hermitian symmetric domain, so one of these case, HDS is a Hermitian symmetric domain, then D automatically is a product, D0 cross D1 cross Dn, where D0 is just Cn mod lambda, where lambda is a lattice inside the translations of Cn. So for instance, you can see that an abelian variety will satisfy this condition, an abelian variety over C. But this will be again of this type. And Di, where I is bigger or equal than bigger than zero, are irreducible in the sense that there are no smaller Hermitian symmetric domains such that decompose in a product, and then a non-Euclidean. And now we will have a dichotomy. Di can be either compact or non-compact. And then we'll say that a factor is of compact type or of non-compact type. So the Hermitian symmetric space, there are three types. There are the Euclideans, that are just Cn mod a lattice of translations. And then the non-Euclideans, that when we decompose in the irreducible, they can be either of compact type or of non-compact type. Okay. And now we have the following, the other theorem. That tells me the following. The irreducible symmetric Hermitian symmetric spaces or Hermitian symmetric domains of non-compact type are exactly the objects of form G mod K, where G is a connected non-compact simply group. With center just E, and K is a maximal connected compact subgroup that has center non-discrete. Okay. So this is exactly all possible irreducible Hermitian symmetric domains of non-compact type. So are the form a simple Lie group quotient by a maximal compact subgroup, but with the condition that the simple Lie group has trivial center, while the maximal compact subgroup has non-discrete center. And in particular, if it has non-discrete center, and is irreducible, one can see that this center has to be exactly U1. And then the complex structure on this quotient is made exactly as I made before, choosing an element such that the action on the orbit of the image of E has order 4, and the square is equal to minus 1, and from this one can get the complex structure. Okay, these are the irreducible Hermitian symmetric space of non-compact type. The ones of compact type. Then we have to do the same with the difference that we'll have to take here a compact group instead of a non-compact group. And instead of taking a maximal compact, I cannot take a maximal compact because maximal compact will be the whole thing. So I just need to take a maximal connected proper subgroup. And this will be just the case of all possible compact groups. So this means that there are not that many. So in fact, I can list all non-compact ones as follows. So they are just SUPQ. Mod out S of UP cross UQ, then SO star 2N divided by UN, then SO 0 2Q, 2 comma Q, divided by SO 2 times SOQ, then SP NR divided by UN and plus two exceptional ones. That are related with the groups E6 and E7. And these are all possible Hermitian symmetric spaces. Here, for instance, SO2Q, this means that this is the special orthogonal group, but with respect to, instead of taking a definite positive Euclidean form, I take a bilinear form of signature 2Q. Here, SUPQ is the same, so I take a Hermitian form of signature PQ. Here, this SO star 2N, this means that this is a subgroup of SOC 2N, but not the standard orthogonal group that is compact, is a non-compact form of the orthogonal group. And these are all. So these are all the non-compact ones are just in this list. Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. Yes, oh, yeah. The what? Which? What is the question? SO?
SL and R, like SL twice. I know SL twice is the same as SU11.
Yes. Yeah, these are, the point is, so. So S-O, S-O, S-L. No, the point is that this does not fit in this picture because we have this example. So if you look at this example, I am saying that SL3R divided by SO3 has real dimension 5. So it can never be an Hermitian symmetric domain. But SO2 is exceptional case. So the point is that SL2R is the same as SO21. And then it fits here. Or is also the symplectic, sorry. I think this is also the same as symplectic 2R. So there are many. So SL2R is one of these exceptional equalities in low dimension. You have the different classical groups are the same. Mm-hmm. So the point is that on the SL line, only SL2 is in this list. But SLN is never there, sorry. So there are very few. As you can see, there are very few in this list. OK. So in some sense, these will be the basic blocks. It's Hermitian symmetric domains. Now, I have given a theorem telling you that there are the compact ones and the non-compact ones. And here I have listed just the non-compact ones. The point is that the compact and the non-compact comes in pairs. So once we have ruled out the Euclidean ones, that are in some sense the special ones, for each non-compact Hermitian symmetric space, there is a compact one. And for each compact one, there is a non-compact one. So all of them come in pairs. And I want to explain a little bit how this works, because this will be needed later for the to understand the complex structure. So I start with D equal to G mod K. This will be an Hermitian symmetric domain of let's say it is of non-compact type. And of course, I have O always the class of the identity. The group G, I am assuming that is the connected component of the identity of the group of allomorphic isometries of D, and K, the stabilizer at zero. So the point is that there are many. So for a the same symmetric domain, there are many possible representations as G mod K, because I can take, for instance, a covering of G, and then I can take another representation. In this theorem, I just was giving you the minimal one. So if I assume that my Lie group has center E, it's the minimal one. But of course, there are other representations. And in some sense, the minimal one is assuming that G is exactly the same as the holomorphic isometries of D. OK. Now I take a zero, which is the isometry fixing the point zero. Remember that it's an Hermitian symmetric domain, so I should have an involution that has zero as the isolated fixed point. And then I can look at sigma, the involution on G that is given just by conjugation by a zero. So this is an involution on G, such that if I look at the fixed points, this is just the compact subgroup. Now I take G, the Lie algebra of G, K, the Lie algebra of K, and this is exactly taking G. Now sigma acts on the group G, it also acts on the Lie algebra, and then K will be just the Eigen space of value 1, and then I define P as the Eigen space for sigma of value minus 1. So I have G is just K direct sum P, and P can be identified with the tangent space at O of B. OK, now this is about the notation. Now,
Okay.
Yeah. Now the question is that G is always algebraic. Because I can put G inside, for instance, GL of the Lie algebra G. And this gives automatically a structure of algebraic group on G. And now, since it is algebraic, I can look at the set of complex points. This will be GC. And then the Lie algebra of this set of complex points is just GC, which is G tensor over R with C. And now inside this algebra, I can look at the following objects. KC will be the same as K. PC will be I times P. So I am twisting P, but letting K to be the same. And GC equal to KC, the exam PC. And now, it turns out that GC determines a compact subgroup GC of GC. So this is the C of complex numbers. This is the C of compact. And I can write the check will be GC mod K. Observe that K is contained in GC. This is a Hermitian symmetric domain of compact type. Okay. So if we start with a Hermitian symmetric domain of non-compact type, we look at the Lie algebra, just twist inside the complexification of G, twist the part P by IP, and I get a compact Hermitian symmetric domain. But this process can be reversed. So if I start with a Hermitian symmetric domain of compact type, I can do the same. I can twist the P part, and I will get a Hermitian symmetric domain of non-compact type. So all these Hermitian symmetric domains, they always come in pairs, one compact and one non-compact. Okay? And now we use the terminology, the compact dual. Means always the compact twin. In the sense that if I start with a Hermitian symmetric domain of non-compact type, then the compact dual will be the compact dual. If I start with an Hermitian symmetric domain of compact type, the compact dual will be itself. And if I start with a product of things, I will take the compact dual on each of the terms in the product. So the compact dual will be always the compact element on this parity. Okay, now that we have this compact twin, let's try to visualize the complex structure. Because we have constructed the complex structure of G mod, so in this G mod K, we have constructed the complex structure taking one element in K that acts, that its square is minus 1 on the tangent space of O, and then translating this complex structure everywhere. Now you can imagine doing complex analysis with such a complex structure. I mean, this will be a nightmare just to check if a function is holomorphic or not, because you have to check all the compatibilities. And normally, we like our complex manifolds or complex spaces, at least locally, to be embedded in some CN. Because then, to check if something is holomorphic is very easy. You just look at the function, and it's clear that you will see whether it is holomorphic or not. So now what we want to do is, instead of having to work with this complex structure, let's try to get a glimpse of this complex structure, a better way to get the complex structure. So now, this is this, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so now we continue with this notation. So we have now an Hermitian symmetric domain, but let's forget for the moment that it is of non-compact type. So we have all this notation. We have the compact dual. And now, using that the center of K is non-discrete, there always exists exists a map U0 that goes from U1 to the group G, such that the action of S of U0 of set is on the tangent space at 0 of D is just multiplication by set. Then the image, so U0 of U1 is contained in K, and K is a centralizer of this U0 of U1. Okay, and this gives us the, in some sense, the complex structure. Now we can write S0 to be just U0 of minus 1, and we will write J0 to be U0 of I. So that this is, yes, this will be the action of minus 1 on the tangent space. So this will be my involution on the tangent space, the involution that fixes 0, and J0 will be just the complex structure on J0. But now J0 acts on this Lie algebra P, and in particular acts also on PC. And now I can decompose PC as P plus this and P minus, where these are the eigenspaces of eigenvalue plus and minus I. And now these are Lie algebras. P plus and pi minus are Lie subalgebras of GC. And in particular, they give rise to Lie groups, P plus and P minus. And then the key point is that if I look at the product KC times P minus, this is a parabolic subgroup of GC, which implies that GC mod out KC times P minus is a complex manifold, complex projective manifold. This one I will call it for the moment X. And then we have the theorem by Borel and Harishchandra that tells us the following thing. First, if I take P plus times KC times P minus to GC, this is injective. So this is the map. So P plus KC and P minus are subgroups of GC. So I can take just the product of the elements. This gives me a map from this product to this group, and this map is injective and contains the real group G we started with. Moreover, if we take the intersection of KC times P minus intersected with G, this is just the compact group K. Now, once we have this equality, now I have the following maps. Yep. Yes.
Is this function compatible with
the complex structure on GC? No.
Not compatible.
No. No, because so the point is that it is compatible with the complex structure on the quotient.
Oh.
On this, so it will be compatible with the complex structure in this quotient here.
Okay.
But it's not compatible with the complex structure here because the action on P minus is minus I.
Okay.
And the action on K is just identity. So it cannot be compatible with the complex structure on this guy.
Oh, I see.
So in some sense I am killing everything such that it is not compatible with this structure. So it's only on P plus where the because P plus is exactly the eigenspace of eigenvalue plus y, plus I. So it's the place where it is compatible. So it will be compatible with the complex structure on the quotient, but not with the complex structure on GC. Okay. So now that we have this, we have the following maps. We have G mod K, which was our Hermitian symmetric domain, for the moment a real object. We have P plus cross KC cross P minus, and this is the same as mod out, sorry, by KC cross P minus. And of course, this is just the same as P plus, because this map was injective. And via the exponential map, this is the same as the Lie algebra P minus, P plus, sorry. And now we have the map to GC mod out KC times P minus. This quotient, which is what I have called X. Now, the theorem tells me that all these maps are open embeddings. And the image of D here is about the domain, the image in this P plus is about the domain. And the image of P plus in X is a Zariski open space. Okay? And now the third part. Is that the space X is exactly the compact dual of D. So this is just the quotient of the compact part divided by D. So what this theorem tells us? So this theorem tells us that I can see the compact dual, not just a quotient of a Lie group by another Lie group, but I can see it as the quotient of a complex Lie group by a parabolic subgroup. So it automatically is a projective manifold. Inside this projective manifold, I have an open affine space, this P plus, that is a Zariski open space. And inside a Zariski open space that is just a complex affine space, I have D as a bounded domain. Hence, I have a very natural way to see the complex structure of D. So in the notes, you have spelled out how to make this program for the easiest case of SL2R, so you can understand a little bit how this works. Okay, so now we have the basic buildings and we can go to the definition of Shimura varieties. Now let's go to the second part, Shimura varieties. At least I will only give the definition of connected Shimura varieties. So now, more definitions. definition one. If I have GA group, and I take gamma 1 and gamma 2 inside G subgroups, we say that they are commensurable. If gamma 1 intersects with gamma 2 has finite index, in both gamma 1 and gamma 2. Okay, so these are commensurable subgroups. And then if I have now G, an algebraic group over Q, okay, so here we are adding some arithmetic structure. Up to now, we're just talking about really groups, semi-simple groups and complex one. Now I am assuming that I have an algebraic group over Q. Let's say it is reductive, for instance. And then I can choose embedding of G inside some GLN C. Then an arithmetic subgroup. Subgroup of G is a subgroup of the form a subgroup commensurable of GQ that is commensurable with GQ intersected with GLN C. Okay? So the idea is that we have our group, a reductive algebraic group over Q. We choose an embedding of G inside GLN C, and then we use this embedding to choose the integral points on this group. So an arithmetic subgroup will be just a subgroup of GQ that is commensurable with the elements with integral coefficients. Of course, this intersection, the intersection of GQ intersected with GLN Z, this depends on the choice of the embedding, but the notion of arithmetic subgroup, so being commensurable with this, is independent on the choice of a particular embedding. But of course, if I start with a really group that might have different algebraic structures, then the notion of arithmetic subgroup will depend on the arithmetic structures, on the rational structure. So if I start with a really group and I look at arithmetic subgroups of the really group, it will depend on the algebraic structure over Q, but once I have chosen the algebraic structure over Q, it will not depend on the fixed embedding I am choosing over to GLN. And finally, an arithmetic subgroup of Q, of G, Q inside G of C is called neat if the subgroup of C star generated by all eigenvalues is torsion free of elements of G. Is torsion free. Okay, so being neat is something of being universally torsion free. So it's in particular so neat. Implies in particular torsion free, but is more than torsion free. And another point is that given any arithmetic subgroup, given gamma inside GQ, an arithmetic subgroup there is always a neat subgroup gamma prime inside gamma of finite index. So in some sense, the neat subgroups are cofinal with respect to inclusions.
Okay.
Now, now we are interested in the quotients of a Hermitian symmetric domain by an arithmetic subgroup. Now we are interested in objects of the form X gamma will be a quotient of D mod gamma. So we have remember that we have our Hermitian symmetric domain is the quotient of G by a compact subgroup. For instance, D is of non-compact type, so G will be non-compact divided by a compact subgroup. We choose an algebraic structure of G over Q, and then we choose an arithmetic subgroup of G over Q. And we want to look at these kind of quotients and what kind of varieties do we get. And then we have the following theorem by Bailey-Borel that tells us the following. So, so let X gamma, so as before, so it's equal to D mod gamma, the quotient of a Hermitian symmetric domain by an arithmetic subgroup of G. Equal to the holomorphic isometries of D. Then X of gamma is an open Zariski subset of a canonically constructed projective variety X gamma star. Okay. In particular, X gamma is an algebraic variety. Okay. So we see that so we have started with a Lie group, we have quotiented out by a compact subgroup, and we get the surprise that we obtain a complex manifold. Now we make a further quotient, we quotient by an infinite subgroup, so this is a covering with infinite pieces, and it turns out that the quotient is now an algebraic variety, always. And this algebraic variety is contained in a projective variety, which is constructed in a canonical way. So one can give a process of constructing this variety adding boundary components, or one can look at certain line bundle on X gamma, look at section of this line bundle, and with this construct this variety as prog of some ring. So it automatically comes from an ample line bundle. And this tells us that it is algebraic over C, but in fact, remark, in fact, it is algebraic. over a number field. So this theorem tells us that it is algebraic over C, but it is even more so, it is an algebraic variety over a number field. Okay. Now we can go to the a little bit further. So now we restrict a little bit the kind of arithmetic subgroups to some subgroups that are easier to understand, which are the congruent subgroups. So definition, we'll take gamma n inside GLn, so this will be the elements G inside GLn C, such that G is congruent with the identity mod n. Okay. So this is the group gamma n, and then a congruent subgroup of GQ is a subgroup that contains G of Q intersected with gamma n with finite index. Okay, so this is a congruent subgroup. So the congruent subgroup are groups that are given by congruence conditions, so that the elements of G are congruent with the identity mod n. And then, of course, a congruent subgroup implies arithmetic subgroup, because gamma n is of finite index inside GLn set. But the opposite, so the other direction, is not true. For instance, even in SL2R or SL2Q, there are many arithmetic subgroups that are not congruent subgroups. Okay, so finally we can give a first definition of a Shimura variety. So connected Shimura datum . So what are connected Shimura datum? So it's the following data. First, I have to choose a semi-simple algebraic group defined over Q. Of non-compact type, in the sense that if I take the real points of this group, I want it to be non-compact. Second part is a connected Hermitian symmetric space. And finally, an action of GR plus on D by a surjective map from GR plus to the is the Hollmann-Fick isometries of D. So a connected Shimura datum will be just a semi-simple algebraic group defined over Q, a connected Hermitian symmetric space. So this will give us the rational structure. Then we have the connected Hermitian symmetric space D. And then I want an action by holomorphic isometries. But I want that this action is transitive. And in particular, to see that it is transitive, I will ask that the map from GR plus is surjective over the connected component of the identity inside the holomorphic isometries. OK, and now that we have the connected simuladatum, we can construct the associated Shimura variety. Associated connected Shimura variety. That will be the node SH0 of GD. Is the tower of spaces. So now I take D divided by gamma over gamma, where gamma runs over all arithmetic subgroups, all neat. Neat arithmetic groups of is the plus whose preimage in G R plus are congruence. So, in some sense, the Shimura variety, instead of being a fixed quotient, is just a tower of all possible spaces that can be constructed as D mod out gamma for all possible arithmetic, for all possible congruent subgroup of GR. So, for instance, in the case of the upper half plane, I can take the tower of all quotients G mod out gamma n. And this will be the Shimura variety. OK, now this definition has several disadvantages. So this definition has two problems. The first problem is that for many number theoretical applications, in particular Langlands program and related things, it is interesting to start with a reductive group. Instead of a semi-simple one. And the second problem that maybe is more serious is that, as I was saying before, the quotient of a Hermitian symmetric space by an arithmetic subgroup has always a model over a number field. But the problem is that in this tower, the number field may change. And for instance, I can look at, so the number field where V mod gamma is defined, changes with gamma. So for instance, I can look at H, in this case, divided by gamma n. So gamma n will be, in this case, the elements of SLN2 set that are congruent with the identity mod n. And this has a model over Q of Xn, where Xn is the root of unity e to 2 pi I divided by n. And we see that as n is bigger and bigger, then the group is bigger and bigger. So then there is a good notion that I will not give of Shimura variety, without the connected Shimura variety, that will start with a reductive group, and normally it is defined in terms of adels, because then it's easier to handle the groups. But the final outcome is that a Shimura variety will be a tower like this. Well, each particular component will be a union of objects of this type, in such a way that when we put all of them together, it will be all defined over the same field. So for instance, now if I take this object, so I can see this object defined over this field. But now I have the inclusion of Q on this field. So I can also imagine this variety as defined over Q. But now if I imagine this variety as defined over Q, and I look at the set of complex points, I will have a lot of components. Then the idea is that gluing together a lot of components, I can get a field of definition. But then the definition involves adels, and it will take me a lot of time to do it, and I prefer to discuss other parts. So I hope that this will be enough. So the point is that tomorrow will be reductive groups, and maybe it will not fit exactly in this definition, but at least what is important is that the connected components of the Shimura varieties that will appear are all of this shape. Okay, and in some sense, for what I want to discuss later, this will be enough. Questions? Okay. Now we have Shimura varieties as locally symmetric spaces, and we want to populate them and get on them some objects to work with. So for instance, we want to construct vector bundles or line bundles on these spaces. Okay, so we go to part three, equivariant vector bundles and invariant metrics. Okay, so now how can we construct a vector bundle on a Hermitian symmetric space? And we want the vector bundle to be equivariant in the sense that we have an action of G. So when we take the quotient by any arithmetic group, it will give us a vector bundle on the quotient. So we start with D is equal to G mod K, an Hermitian symmetric space. And B is a complex vector space. Now, I can look at the map G to G mod K. This is what is called a principal K bundle. In the sense that I have an action of G on G of K on G on the right. So I have K and then I have an action on the right by K, and then the quotient of this action is just this Hermitian symmetric space. Now I choose rho, a representation of K inside this GL of B. So now I have K acting on G on the right, and I have also K acting on the left on B. So now I can form the following product, G times B over K. This is by definition the product G times B mod out the equivalence relation G times K comma B is equivalent to J comma K times B. Now what is this construction? So since this construction, what is doing me is to replace the K fiber of this bundle. So this bundle has fibers equal to K. I have this representation of K inside GLB, and then I am changing the K fibers by B fibers. So what I get is that this object has a map to G mod K, and the fibers are just equal to B. And in fact, they have a structure of a vector bundle. So G cross K is a vector bundle over D equal to G. And what is interesting is that it's not only a vector bundle, but it is a equivariant. In the sense that I have an action of G acting on this G cross B over K, G prime times G comma B is equal to G prime G comma B. So the action is just acting on the G space. Okay. But this is just a purely differentiable vector bundle. So this has no, for the moment, no complex structure. So I have constructed a complex, so I am assuming that B is a complex vector space. So I have constructed a complex vector bundle, but I would like to have at least an holomorphic vector bundles to have at least a chance that the quotient will be some kind of algebraic vector bundle. How we can get a holomorphic structure? On this B, so let's write G cross B over K, this will be curly B. Well, this is why we have studied how to put a complex structure on G mod K. So the idea will be, since I have B is a complex vector space, and I have a representation of K, I can easily complexify to get a representation of KC. Now I can extend to KC times P minus by declaring that the action of P minus is trivial. But here we are making a choice. So in some sense, the first step, there is no choice to be made. If I have any representation of K, there is a unique way to complexify. But here there is a choice. So I am choosing that the action of P minus is trivial. And I could have chosen otherwise. But in some sense, this is the easiest choice. But now I have a rho prime. It's a representation, Kc times P minus to GL B is a representation of Kc times P minus. And now I can do the same trick, but now in the holomorphic category. So I can look at Gc times B over Kc times P minus, which will be just Gc cross B mod out the equivalence relation as before, G comma Gk comma B is equivalent to J comma Kb. This will be BH. And this is a holomorphic vector bundle. On the compact dual space. So the advantage of doing this is that now we automatically get an holomorphic vector bundle on the compact dual. And now if I restrict BH to B, it is canonical isomorphic. So it's isomorphic to B as C infinity vector bundles. So it gives me a holomorphic structure. Now the choice of assuming that the extension to P minus is trivial will mean that this kind of vector bundle is special, and these are what they are called fully decomposable vector bundles. Okay. And fully decomposable comes from the fact that in this product, P minus is the unipotent radical, and hence we're assuming that the action of the unipotent radical is trivial, hence we'll be able to decompose.
Okay, now do we need this? Okay.
Now, one thing that is useful for explicit computations is that this bundle comes from with a trivialization. So I look at let pi, the map from GC to this quotient to the dual. Then if I take the pullback of PH, I pull back to GC, this is canonical isomorphic to GC cross B. So it comes from a canonical trivialization. And now, if I choose a map S that goes from D to GC, that in some sense is a section of pi, so such that if I make the composition P composed with S is just the embedding of X inside the compact dual. So I choose any section like this, then we see that BH restricted to X is the same as S upper star of B upper star of BH. But the upper star of BH was trivial, so this is now automatically trivialized. So it comes with a trivialization, but this trivialization depends on the choice of the section S. So for instance, we can choose as S, remember that we have this symmetric domain inside P plus, which in turn is inside GC. So this is a so it's natural choice of this section that satisfies this property, and that gives us a particular choice of a section. OK, maybe it's time for an example. So let's go.
Yep.
Oh, sorry. X. Oh. Yeah, the Hermitian symmetric space is D. X will be the quotient Y gamma. And I still have not made the quotient here. OK, so now we need an example. So we are in the case D equal to the upper half plane, and then K is just SO2, which is the same as U1. Now this is an abelian group, hence all irreducible representations are one-dimensional, and in fact the irreducible representation of K are in bijection with the integers, and is the so let's say some integer k corresponds to the representation rho k of z applied to b equal to z to the k multiplied by b. So all representations of u1 are just of this type and are classified with by the weight. Okay, now
okay.
Now in the notes, you will find a series of exercises that will show that if you apply this process, you can find that now this will give us a line bundle on H. Now sections, so this will be LK. Now sections of LK will be in correspondence with functions on H, holomorphic functions, because of the trivialization. So every time I have a trivial line bundle on a space, I can identify sections of this line bundle with functions. But now the point is, what is the action of G on sections? Then what we will have is that the action has exactly the same property. So F is G invariant if and only if F at some gamma times tau is equal to C tau plus D to the K times F of tau, where gamma is just A, B, C. So we recover, as a particular case of all we have been given, the original definition, at least part of the definition, so I still have to take the quotient by gamma, of modular forms. So modular forms are just the line bundle of modular forms is just the line bundle corresponding to the representation of the group K of weight K. and these are the modular forms of WebKit. Okay, so this is all for today, and then tomorrow we will put metrics on these vector bundles and then try to do Arakelov theorem on these Hermitian vector bundles. Thank you.